Now, the first speech of this session is Islamic recipe for avoiding society's ill. And the speaker is Saifur Rahman Saab. Saifur Rahman Saab, please.
Ashhadu la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh amma ba'du fa'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Respected chairman, my dear brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Initially I was planning to begin my speech with numbers and figures breaking down the moral degradation in our society and the rise and how it's fallen and fallen and fallen into despair. But while searching through for these numbers, naturally I was on Google and I came across link after link for recovery websites such as Alcoholics Anonymous, the Betty Ford Clinic, other Christian and other faith-based organizations and sites. All were recommending ways to heal oneself, ways to find cures for their diseases, and how to avoid social ills. Looking at all of this, I came to the realization that whether we are Muslim, Christian, Jewish, atheist, or any other denomination, we're all facing similar social and moral dilemmas. How do we live a good and a God-fearing life and try to avoid and condemn evils such as drug abuse, alcoholism, domestic violence, adultery, and other social harms? Even our government recognizes these problems and is constantly trying to spend more and more money coming up with new schemes to combat these. But the question is, are these schemes working? Some of you who weren't raised in this country or didn't study U.S. history might not know that the U.S. government actually one time abolished the sale of alcohol. It was actually made an amendment to the Constitution in 1919. And they made it illegal because they knew that alcohol was a vice and a root to many social problems, from backbiting, promiscuity, domestic abuse, other crimes. And they decided that outlawing it would solve these problems. So what was the result? We had the rise of bootlegging, organized crime, the mafia, politicians and policemen who would go after these criminals during the day, or the alcohol runners by day, would have their own private stashes at night. Bootlegging, contraband, and illegal consumption of liquor loosened respect not merely for that law, but for all law, while social behavior and morals slid downhill at avalanche speeds. It was such a failure that they repealed it only 14 years later. Now let's compare this prohibition to another act of prohibition, one that started almost 1,500 years ago from the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and is still being practiced to this day. We see Muslims all over the world jealously guarding their lips from alcohol and trying to live their lives free from it. Indeed, for many of them, they've never even thought of touching it. So one may ask, what could have happened in Islamic history that has kept millions of Muslims around the world away from this habit, whereas the government of our nation failed so miserably? Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, O ye who believe, wine and the game of chance and idols and divining arrows are only an abomination of Satan's handiwork. So shun each one of them that you may prosper. Satan seeks only to create enmity and hatred among you by means of wine and the game of chance, and to keep you back from the remembrance of Allah and from prayer. Then will you keep back. Anas bin Malik relates, when that verse was revealed, we were holding a drinking party in the house of Abu Talha when the Prophet's voice reached us, calling, O Muslims, take note that intoxicants are forbidden, or a forbidden sin, and should be poured out into the streets. Abu Talha asked me to take all the intoxicants from my house and pour them from his house and pour them out for him, which I did, taking them into the street where some of the bottles broke while others were washed and cleansed. So much was poured onto the streets of Medina that day that for a long time thereafter, whenever it rained, the color and smell of wine came up from the ground. All it took for the Muslims was to hear the voice of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling them that alcohol is forbidden, and it was gone. The total and instant obedience shown that day spread rapidly throughout all of the lands under Islamic law, and is still holding up to this day. So what was the difference between this type of prohibition and the prohibition the U.S. government tried to uphold? Simply put, one was flawed, man-made law, whereas the other came with the force of divine command, a God-inspired statute interpreted to the men in the light of reason and common sense by the Holy Prophet of God, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So then, when we go back to my original dilemma, that if all people, or for people from all religions, are trying to fight off the same moral social ills, what makes us Muslims different? The answer is that Allah has given us a set of divine laws and a way of life which prepares us to combat any and every one of these social challenges. We can't blame the society which we live in for our personal weaknesses and excuses, or that we live in the West, so it's much harder over here. That's long expired. In this day and age, all types of social ills are found in every country, in all parts of the world, including the Eastern countries. So the question is not how do we change the society around us, but how do we, as Ahmadi Muslims, better safeguard ourselves from the challenges that any society can throw at us? My friends, the title of my speech today is Islamic Recipe for Avoiding Social Ills. And as Ahmadi Muslims, we not only have the divine recipe from the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in front of us, but we have a master chef in the form of our beloved Khalifa to guide us through every step of it. If we look at our beautiful teachings, there are endless guidelines for us on how to live the best possible life. Days and days of speeches couldn't capture all of the wisdom that's given to us through the Holy Quran and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, as I started to look through this endless amount of material, I was drawn to this hadith in Al-Bukhari that I feel provides us with an effective goal on how to achieve, an effective recipe on how to achieve this goal. Hazrat Abu Bakr narrated that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was once asked that should he not warn them against the three major sins? All of them said, "Certainly, O Prophet." Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, "To ascribe partners with Allah, to disobey the parents." Raising himself up as he was reclining, he then said, "To tell a lie or to give false evidence." He went on repeating his words for such a long time that we wished him to be silent. From this beautifully simple yet deeply profound hadith, we can see that our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam practically handed us a foolproof recipe. Its three ingredients are: number one, remembrance of Allah; obedience to the parents; and honesty. If we follow these guidelines, it will not only impact every aspect of our lives, but safeguard us from all social challenges and ills. Firstly, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us not to ascribe partners with Allah, which in simple terms means that we must worship just one God. Of course, the best form of worship is our salat, our five daily prayers. On Hazur's recent visit to the U.S. in June, in his Friday sermon, he stressed the importance of offering each prayer at its appointed time, and to plan our daily activities around these prayers and times, instead of slotting our prayers hastily in between our worldly plans. In another khutbah from earlier this year, Hazur said that the Quran lays emphasis on salat, and the Holy Prophet ﷺ called it the high point, or zenith of a believer. The Quran states, "Surely prayer restrains one from indecency and manifest evil." The observance of salat helps us guard against the negative influences of the world in two ways. The first way is it constantly helps us remember Allah throughout the day, which keeps our thoughts and intentions away from temptations, and also remembers us and instills taqwa. In many speeches at the mosque, we hear of taqwa. We're told to have taqwa. What is it? It is to carry out all of our actions for Allah's pleasure and to fear His displeasure. But how much do we really actively apply it in our daily lives? If a boxer aspires to become a world champion, he can't expect to achieve it without a lot of work. He has to go through a strenuous daily training session, eat the proper proteins, have a proper sleep plan, and then maybe he'll achieve this goal. Similarly, without putting in constant effort to remember Allah in all of our actions, we can't expect to be successful in combating the bad influences around us. By offering our salat throughout the day, it helps remind us of our love for Allah and His love for us, and in turn draws our attention back towards living a life with taqwa. The second way that salat helps us to avoid social ills is that the five daily prayers are like five preset appointments that we've made with God. If we start our day by giving these appointments top priority, it gives us little opportunity to allow other worldly activities to control our plans. Let me demonstrate with an everyday example. Say your boss says after work we're going to have a meeting, an informal meeting at a restaurant. You go hoping that it will help you move up. After the meeting, your boss has left. A few of your colleagues are going to stay by. There's no rush. They decide to grab a round of drinks. You notice that it's also approaching prayer time. This is when you have to decide what you're going to do. If you started the day with the intention of reading your prayers on time, you would definitely opt to leave, go home, and not risk missing your appointment with Allah. On the other hand, if a person is not as committed to honoring their prayer times, they would be tempted to stay and socialize. And there's a saying, an idle mind is a devil's workshop. And this is exactly what this kind of scenario could lead to. When you don't have set priorities and you allow others to decide your plans, you are more likely to lose control of the situation. In this example that I just mentioned, it is a slippery slope when you mingle in a non-work, co-ed environment where people are consuming alcohol and a slew of temptations can present themselves. For this very reason, the remembrance of Allah, specifically through Salat, is one of the most important and main ingredient for our recipe that Islam provides. The next ingredient that I mentioned was our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned is the obedience to parents. In Surah Luqman, verse 15, Allah says, "And we have enjoined on man to be good to his parents. His mother bears him in weakness upon weakness, and his weaning takes 2 years. Give thanks to me and thy parents. Unto me is the final return." Our parents are the core of our family structure, and the Islamic family system is well protected by moral law. During a question and answer session with Khalifa Rabi, Rahimullah, he said the following, "If you stick to Islamic moral laws, then it is impossible for you to be drawn to outside worldly pleasures to a degree where the center of gravity shifts from the house to the streets or dance halls and so on. Nowadays, according to the Western social system, gradually and constantly, the interest of the family of family members has changed more from within the house to outside the house. Practically, they're using their houses as motels nowadays. They come, have a nice rest, have a good breakfast, and then run away, returning late at night when they are totally exhausted, and sometimes they have lost their command of their senses because of over-drinking, and sometimes they beat their wives and innocent children, and so on." In this observation, Khalifa Rabi accurately described how the lack of a structured family atmosphere can allow the social ills found outside our homes to creep in, like vines which slowly intertwine around our legs and try to pull us into the moral landslide around us. Unfortunately, I witnessed this firsthand at work on a daily basis. As a public defender for the last 6 years, I've represented children as young as 12 who are charged with assault and robbery, and as old as 80 who are charged with something as little as drunken public, and everything in between. These people go in and out of jail for years and years, in and out of programs for years and years, until they finally realize, you know what? I spent more than half of my adult life going in these systems, or they just end up dying. I'm asked many, many times by many people, "Saf, who commits the most crimes? What race do you see in jail the most?" And every time I think about it, the honest answer is, the common denominator of all of my clients is the lack of a family structure. It's not race, it's not culture, but the lack of a family structure. It's the parents' responsibility to establish a household in which Salat is read in congregation and where an atmosphere of a love and respect is present so that the family desires to spend time together. And in turn, it is the responsibility of the children, no matter their age or stage in life, to show unwavering obedience to their parents. Parents must be aware of their children's activities, knowing who their children's friends are and what they're involved in does not make them nosy, but merely concerned parents who are carrying out their duty. If the police were searching your house and they found some contraband in one room, they could arrest anybody that has access to that room in this house. So unless your child locks his room and is the only one with the key to that room, if something illegal is found in that room, any of you can be charged. That's the way the law works. So it is your responsibility to know what's in your house. It is for this reason that we as children must each bury our pride, arrogance, and anger, and offer unreserved respect and honesty to our parents. This then brings us to the final ingredient of our recipe, which is honesty. Honesty is a trait that in this day and age is underrated. The lack of it is the root of many, many sins and other moral problems affecting society, such as backbiting, adultery, gambling, and other crimes. Cheating and illegal forms of business are all based on the concept of deceiving others and hiding one's hurtful actions for personal gain. This concept breeds a false impression of self-importance in a person, making them only think of their own goals and desires, which can in turn lead them into believing that they are themselves superior to the watchful eye of Allah, a form of shirk by itself. It is related that once someone asked the Holy Prophet ﷺ for advice because that person was suffering from many weaknesses and did not think that he could leave all of them at once. The Holy Prophet ﷺ told him, "Promise that you will always speak the truth and will never tell a lie." Just by adopting the path of truthfulness, he was freed from all of his sins one by one. Whenever he thought of committing a sin, he imagined that he would be presented before the Holy Prophet ﷺ. He had promised not to tell a lie. If he were to speak the truth about a sinful act he committed, he might be punished or humiliated. Gradually, by adopting this advice of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, he was freed from all of his sins. Like that companion of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we all suffer from weaknesses that we want to change in ourselves. This simple hadith shows us that it is never too late to start implementing ways to help bring about this change in us. We can take the example of some of our dear convert brothers and sisters who might not have found this beautiful recipe of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until later on in life. But applying this formula the Prophet gave, they have no problem changing any bad habits. I was reading a story in our book, The Dawn's Early Light. One brother from New York explained how he was a street hustler, a very good one. What that essentially means is that he was very good at lying, at being deceitful. He wasn't raised in an Ahmadi household, yet was able to change his ways by removing falsehoods from his life. Alhamdulillah, he found the right path. Even for those of us that are born as Ahmadi Muslims, we go through trials and tribulations and still correct ourselves, or still try to correct ourselves and change our ways. It is easy to let our environment influence the way we act, but as Ahmadi Muslims, it should in fact be our acts that influence the environment around us. Islam provides us with an abundance of resources and teachings to live a fruitful and peaceful and God-fearing life. The environment around us provides us with enough harmful opportunities and traps to divert us from this path. However, there is no doubt in my mind that by remembering and acting upon such a simple recipe from Allah Ta'ala, that is, by not associating partners with Allah and consciously reading our salat on time, by creating a solid family structure and being obedient to one's parents, and by removing any grain of dishonesty from our thoughts and actions in our everyday lives, we are not only changing our society, but more importantly, we are changing how the society around us is able to influence us, and with Allah's help, we will be able to avoid the social harms of this world. Jazakallah. Ameen.